afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's so nice to see you all here to welcome you to Cambridge and to launch officially this wonderful project for which the ESRC has very kindly given us some funding. So I've become a senior fellow in the UK and Changing Europe project, and there are a number of us here. And part of the project is about communicating as much information as possible to as wide a group of people as possible, as well as in somehow fitting in the research which goes with the project. And our project's called Honeypot Britain with a large question mark. And this comes from the Daily Mail. And I should say I've now become an avid reader of the Daily Mail because, frankly, it gives you a taste of what's going on in certain parts of the world, perhaps that you wouldn't actually find out about just living in Cambridge. What we want to know, in essence, is whether people are drawn to the UK because of the allegedly very generous benefits that we offer here. Now, this research has been built on some earlier work that we've been doing about looking at the extent to which EU8 migrants have been using the tribunals to enforce their employment rights. And in a couple of minutes, Amy's going to summarise briefly what we found there as a lead-in to what we're going to say and what we're going to be discussing today. You have in front of you a programme and a list of participants. I should say that, as you can see, this event is being filmed. And again, this ties in with the UK and the Changing Europe objective of communicating as much information as possible, as widely as possible. And so if there is any time that you would like to the filming to stop because of something you want to say which you do not want filmed, please let us know and we will turn the cameras off. So without more ado, although Amy, oh there she is, Amy's going to just very briefly present what we've done so far and where we've got up to, and then we will hand the floor over for the afternoon session.
So as Catherine mentioned, our interest in this field, though it predates this project, stems most recently from a two-year piece of work that Catherine and I have been engaged in, looking at the extent to which migrant workers from EU8 countries, so 2004 accession states, enforce their rights, their employment rights, in employment tribunals in the UK. And this came out of Catherine's examination at employment appeal tribunal level, and we thought that this would be a really easy question to answer, that the government would keep information about this sort of thing. We actually discovered that they don't. So we've had to manually search through lots of employment tribunal decisions to work out whether we think that EU8 migrant workers might be bringing these claims or not. So these three killer points represent just very crudely our findings. So we looked through all employment tribunal cases for 2010 to 2012, and we found that at most we could identify 1,548 cases being brought by EU8 workers who we thought was probably going to be migrants. Most conservatively within that sample, we said there were 46 EU8 migrant workers, more realistically about 200. But however we cut the figures, it was very clear that this was a significant underrepresentation of EU8 workers using the employment tribunal system to vindicate their employment rights. And in terms of representation, probably most interestingly, we found that migrant workers who were making use of tribunals were excessively in person, so appearing without the benefits of a lawyer, weren't having the benefits of support from the Citizens Advice Bureau or trade unions as much as we might have thought. And so that interest in enforcement or lack of use of tribunals among certainly the EU8 population to enforce labour rights led into the Honeypot Britain project. And you can see there a quote from David Cameron with the Honeypot Britain hypothesis reflected there. And so we are interested in the rules that give rise to this purported Honeypot Britain problem, as well as empirically investigating the nature and extent of that problem. So what we're doing at the moment is interviewing and conducting focus groups with EU nationals more broadly, so going beyond the EU8 community now, to understand what it is that brings them to the UK. Is it indeed, as David Cameron suggested, its benefits, or are there other things? Who are these migrants who are often described as one homogenous group? What are their very personal stories? And moving beyond that, then, we're going to do a piece of work that replicates our enforcement methodology, but looking at social security cases in the upper tier tribunal. And we're hoping that we're going to communicate some of our research through producing a documentary. So we're just at the start of what's quite a difficult process to engage with some of the migrant communities directly face to face. So we're spending a lot of time in lots of exotic locations, in fields, in factories, in clubs down in London, in community grassroots advice organisations. I was this morning at an ESOL class. So we're all over the shop. So I will now hand back over to Julie.
I'll just run.
Or Catherine? Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So that gives you an idea of what our little bit of the UK and a Changing Europe project is about. And one of the things that we've actually grappled with at a very basic level is terminology, how we describe the people who are moving. And I was very struck by the Daily Mail yesterday with their graphic headline about 1 million migrants coming on their way, and there's a hint, the words Europe and Gove are there, and with Gove saying Britain has no control over who we let in. Now, of course, the migrants that the Daily Mail is in fact referring to are those coming from third countries, and of course there's a political agenda going on that we're probably all very aware of, but what we are very much looking at today is the EU dimension of this, so those moving from one EU state to another, who of course we term as migrants, but it's very striking that when you look at the coverage of the Britons abroad, which is only an issue that seems to have raised its head recently in the consciousness of certain parts of the press, they're all expats. So expats are obviously good things and doing good things by going abroad, whereas migrants are probably coming here to claim benefits. So on that note, if I can hand the floor over to Julie, who's coming, going to chair this session.
Thank you. Yes. Do we need microphones?
Can you hear without the microphones? Do you need the microphones for filming?
There's one on there as well.
Okay,
it's fine.
Thank
okay.
you.
Indeed. You are fourth panellist. Please. I'll move to the middle. What Catherine hasn't said is that it is a very dangerous thing to have invited me, because the ESRC has decided that I'm a very dangerous political animal. And I wrote a blog for them, for their UK and Changing Europe website, at their request, and said, well, why hasn't it gone up? And they said, the advisory board didn't like it. We liked your first one because you did that about national parliaments. And as an academic on national parliaments, you're seen as an expert. And writing about David Cameron, well, we think you're too political, so we couldn't put it up. Meanwhile, Nigel Lawson, who, in case anybody wasn't aware, lives in France. He stands up on a regular basis in the House of Lords and says, I live in France. Is invited on a regular basis to speak to the UK and to Changing Europe. So I'm not quite sure how he is less political than I am. But I'm delighted to be here today, only wearing my academic hat. So hopefully the ESRC and Anand will not get into trouble for asking me to speak, or at least to chair this session. And I shall sit very quietly and allow the speakers to introduce themselves. And I won't abuse the chair in any way, because obviously I wouldn't like to overly politicise a subject which is clearly not going to be political in any way. The speakers have all been asked to speak. Originally it said for 2 minutes. In fact, they're allowed to speak for up to 10 minutes. And since I haven't been given CVs, I'm going to suggest they introduce themselves. We also have Heidi Allen, the MP for South Cambridgeshire. So anyone that's not aware, Cambridge is the centre of a donut, and South Cambridgeshire runs all the way around Cambridge City. Are you hoping to say a few words, and are you happy to go?
Well, I'm your guest, you invited me. I have literally half an hour, which is ridiculously short, but such is my life. But if anybody, I suppose, had any questions from the floor, then I'd be we're very happy to kind of field them. But it's predominantly your event, really, so I'm just a support act if there's anything anybody wants to ask me, really.
Well, I think you asked Kylie to make a few remarks right at the beginning and take a few questions right at the beginning.
Yeah.
So, yes.
Well, if she says something for 5 or 10 minutes or whatever.
Forgive me, that's not why I'm here.
No, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Are you happy to take some questions?
Questions, certainly, yeah. But I'm certainly not here to make a speech. It's your event, and I'm just here to sort of add any kind of information from the government, really, if anybody has any questions around that. But, it's your event, so I certainly don't want to railroad it or make a speech of any kind.
Are there any questions? Marcus is twitching. Marcus Gehring, who is the Deputy Director of the Centre for European Legal Studies.
Yeah, I'm...
Who may be exercising his rights of free movement.
Absolutely, I'm exercising my rights to free movement, and the first question that came to my mind was, how should I explain to my 7 and 10-year-old EU migrants that there are certain people in the government, in positions of power, who consistently get the law wrong and sort of use very populist, very sort of low-level arguments in order to pursue a political point that is actually impacting people's lives very directly. I find that, from a political point of view, very, very difficult, and I don't envy you as the MP sitting on the Conservative benches and sharing those benches with people who, quite frankly, are insulting me and my kids on a daily basis.
Should we start with hello?
Hello.
That's quite a statement. I'm not actually sure that I'm here to respond to something like that. Do you want to be specific? That's quite a general statement you've made. Specifically, what is it that you're...
Yeah, so the Justice Minister says that... what did he say? That nothing the Prime Minister negotiated was legally binding.
Which I understand is not absolutely not the case. It is legally binding.
Yeah, so are you saying the Justice Minister got the law wrong?
wishing to stay friendly and polite, yeah. I'm not here to yeah. justify what the Justice Secretary has or hasn't do. I'm an invited guest. If people have specific questions about my views on Europe, I'm not here to defend the government or to give views on whether Michael Gove is legally knowledgeable or not. That's a bit of an unfair position, I think, to put into.
No, the broader question is, don't you think the entire discussion leading up to the referendum has an impact on people's lives? And there are lots of people in your constituency that are impacted by this discussion. And what are you doing to maybe mitigate or alleviate their worries?
My view on the referendum is very simple. Everybody has a vote. My vote is no more powerful than yours. My job...
I don't have a vote, so...
Okay. I think maybe that's a good thing, I'm not sure. I will vote to stay in. That is my view, and that is what I will express to constituents. Will I railroad them? Will I lobby them hard? No, I won't. What I will try and do is provide information to the people. People are educated in Cambridge, so they can make up their own minds. What they don't have is a great deal of evidence and information about what life might be like afterwards if we come out. And I see it as my job to do my very best to try and provide that for them. But will I lobby hard? Will I be banging on doors trying to convince people of my point of view? No, I won't. Because I think that's disrespectful and people need to make their own conclusions. And it's my job to filter out some of that noise and take the politics almost out of it. This is a decision that should be based on fact and evidence. A little bit of passion. I visited the refugee camps in Lesbos recently, and my goodness me, that made me feel that the world is an incredibly small place, getting smaller every day. For me, I want to be part of a team to try and fix those humanitarian issues. So for me, it's gone beyond pounds, shillings and pence. But I just want to provide people with information to make their own decisions.
I have a question as well. You say that this discussion should be based on evidence and should be informed and so on, which I totally agree with that. But there are parts of the country where Cambridge is perhaps not such a part, but there are parts in the country where people simply just do not accept the evidence. For example, the question of benefits. There is evidence that migrants not only cover what they take out in from the social system. They also contribute a surplus. And there are people out there who simply do not accept that is the case.
They are in Cambridgeshire as well. Two of them emailed me last night.
Perhaps
that's
so
delightfully
in another part of the country. So my question would be, what is the government doing in respect of those parts of the country?
Well, I think the message has to be consistent everywhere, you know. But, you know, I'm new to politics, I'm a business person, and I find it staggering the speed with which, I apologise, I feel like I've got my back to half the room. I find it staggering the speed with which propaganda and opinion and media and spin suddenly becomes what everybody's thinking. But it happens every single day. Thank you. And I think, and then you mix a good healthy dose of ego in there as well. And it's just a very powerful cocktail for people's opinions to be swayed based on anything other than evidence, actually. And I think what a good politician should do, you know, you are the representative, you are the person that brings the information to people, is they should try and park as much of that as they can and just deliver the consistent message of information. We don't really know what the world would be like outside of the EU. That's broadly speculation. But I think it's particularly difficult, to be honest, in the Conservative Party at the moment, because everything you're reading is absolutely right. The fractions, it's just People's Front of Judea versus the Judeans People's Front at the moment. It's ridiculous. Whether Boris will bring some kind of cohesion to the Out campaign, I don't know. But certainly the Prime Minister launched the In campaign this week, and it's our job to be professional, I think, really, and make sure that that professional message using the media permeates the whole of the country. But it's not easy, because some of those views are very heavily ingrained already.
Well, that's really the point. I mean, how do you speak to people who do not accept hard data and hard evidence? You know, how do you reason with people like that?
Well, you're assuming that they've had the hard data.
Well, I often speak to people and I say, well, there's research from UCL and other universities and so on, and it clearly shows X, Y, and Z. Mm. Well, no, that's just simply not the case. Well, how do you reason with people?
But the overall populace won't be receiving hard data like that.
Yes.
You know, and I think perhaps, you know, you have some examples of people you've spoken to, but there are, you know, I find in politics, you're overwhelmed by the number of people and views out there, and it is really difficult to connect. But, you know, we can all only do what we can do, which is professionalism, information, data, take the ego out of it, take the brave heart element out of it, let's stick to facts. You know, I'm a scientist, let's stick to facts. And we all have to do that and just push the message out.
Can I just ask one question about that?
Sorry, can I ask people to introduce themselves when you speak so that I don't know everybody and certainly Heidi won't? So,
James Dixon, I'm a barrister from Number 5 Chambers. I do practice in EU law, amongst other areas of law. Just on this issue of how the In campaign will be presented, because of course, one of the things that Cameron is emphasising, understandably for certain reasons, is the concession wrought around benefits and the 4-year, the emergency break and all of that. Is it, well, one thing I've been asking myself, is it possible to present that case, but also, picking up on what Agatha's just said, also, as it were, inform people that actually EU migrants contribute more than they take out, because on one level the two are almost contradictory, or could be seen as almost contradictory, those two messages. So I'm just wondering how that can be dealt with.
One cancels out the other, or
well, there it's a more nuanced and subtle position to put across than the no than the exit campaign, I suppose, what I'm saying.
And I think the other thing that we could do, just following on to your question, in addition to that, because you're right, it's how you brand those messages, isn't it, and how you twist people's perception, or have you thought of it this way? But, you know, we also, you know, my husband's worked in sales and marketing all his life, so he understands customers and what makes them buy, and that's what this is about at the end of the day. How do we get people to buy the decision to stay in? And you have to be selling them the things that they're interested in. So actually, if the thing about migration benefits is a closed door, they're just not going to hear you, then we need to start selling them different products. And those different products could be security around our membership in this uncertain world, Putin, what on earth is he doing, etc., etc. That's the message, that's the sales product they want to buy. So perhaps rather than flogging a dead horse that they're just never going to buy, we should be focusing on other messages and things that they are more receptive to hearing. I think security, you know, parliamentary sovereignty, those sorts of arguments are perhaps, that's more of an open door to push, because some things, you know, they're just too entrenched.
Right.
And, I'm sorry. Also in their part of the world, they won't necessarily see migrants contributing, because they're not all, let's be honest, you know, just parts of the country, really regionalised how people feel about migrants, actually the contributions to the local economy. So, you know, no matter how you express it, that's not what they're seeing locally.
Here, and then the lady there, and then gentleman.
I'm Geoffrey Everton, politics in university. You've answered the question partially, but I mean, I assume you support the Prime Minister's package. But how important do you think that package is, both for the referendum and for the European Union and the UK, if we stay?
Well, the package is the package, isn't it? I mean, we're not going to get a better one now, so that is, and it does tickle me slightly that Boris seems to be suggesting that he'll get a better package if he's allowed to be, Prime Minister, maybe. there's a thought. I think, is it brilliant? No. Is it broadly acceptable? Yes. Does it ultimately, if it secures us a seat still within Europe, if it's good enough for the electorate, it convinces them? You know, it's like any organisation change. Europe is a tanker ship, and there are parts that all of us would want to change by way of bureaucracy. But you know, you've got to be in there to change it. And for me, it would start the beginning of a new relationship that says, yes, okay, we've stayed, we're here, we had some compromise, thank you very much, but let's develop this relationship now that's ready for the next generation. But you know, if we're not part of it, we can't do that. So do I think the package is brilliant? No. Is it good enough? Just about. Is it all we're going to get? Yes.
Thank you.
My name is Christina Ziegler McPherson. I'm an American historian. And the government has said that it wants to reduce immigration to the tens of thousands. And I'm wondering if you think this treaty can come anywhere near achieving that. And if not, what do you think would actually do so?
I think while our economy continues to outperform a lot of Europe, all the treaties in the world are not going to make a blinding bit of difference. And here's a slightly controversial thought, maybe. I don't know within in this room. I feel a little bit unprepared, actually, because I didn't hear the beginning of your meeting. I don't know what side of the fence people are on, so I'm taking a bit of a punt here. There is part of me, and I see it certainly in places like Cambridge, where actually I think I want those brains to come here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm actually not so hung up on the numbers as a lot of the politicians are. Mm-hmm. I think if the economy is doing well, and you know, of course we came into this with huge deficit, etc. But actually, if financially we were in a better position, do you think we'd all be moaning so much about the migrant numbers? I'm not sure we would, actually. But it's because, you know, the hospitals are struggling, infrastructure, all the same reasons we're here, that people are unable to cope with this concept of all these extra people coming here. Yes, of course we have to get the numbers down. But I think we're pushing a water uphill whilst our economy is significantly ahead of the others. But for me, if I was PM, which is never going to happen, would I have a target of that low level? I don't think I would, actually. And it's too broad.
Taking university students out of the numbers would help a bit.
Yes.
Gentlemen here.
Taz Tesla, Chairman of the Federation of Poles. I was recently interviewed on Polish television, 10-second slot, asking what my opinion was of the Polish Premier's decision to agree to support Cameron. And I said, listen, it's obvious, it's a loss situation for Poland. It's good because the Poland are gaining benefit from the migrants that are here. But my question is really something completely different. What do you consider? Do you consider it logical that people, that migrants, are allowed to vote for European members of parliament, for the local councillors, and yet they cannot participate in a referendum?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of them have been for 5 years, 10 years. They're effectively residents in this country now. And it seems a bit odd that the decisions that are being arrived at will affect them more than anybody else or their families, and yet they have no voice at all in the matter. I think it's a very important. What do you consider? Is there any way? There's no way around it.
No,
now.
It won't be changed.
But, you know, it seems very, very.
Well, my mum's German.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
So you know.
Yeah. I think probably this referendum will be the, the last bastion of British Commonwealth-ness, of insular-looking-ness,
if that makes sense to you. And then we move on, hopefully. And this is your work, get on with it.
Final question, and then we'll go to the main panel.
Just to reinforce your point about migration and the treaties, to the regional arrangements that arguably have more internal migration than the EU, even though they don't allow for it, ASEAN and NAFTA, where the levels are very high in both, albeit ASEAN are concentrated. But my question was slightly different. I saw the coverage, and you spoke very movingly about what you'd seen in Lesbos. And whether we stay in the EU or not, how do you think you and the government will take forward possible issues of burden sharing, be it either financially or in terms of taking refugees, given that the situation is likely to intensify, not get any better?
My fear is if we are not in the EU, Britain will do a very British thing and just batten down the hatches and say it's your problem, actually. And I think from a humanitarian and moral point of view, that's wrong. What I saw was a desperate need for organisation. Greece has been dumped on royally. And it does make me smile, given that we were berating them financially not that long ago to get the house in order, and only then might we let you stay in the gang. But actually now it's quite handy that you're here, because you can just deal with this problem, thank you very much. I think the way that they've been left us to deal with it is absolutely unacceptable. For me, if we are in Europe, we are a team. We share that burden, we share that sense of strategy, and we come up with a plan to deal with it. At the moment, I think European leaders are like bunnies in headlines. They have no idea what to do. And they're not talking to each other, and it's conveniently Greece's problem. And I feel Britain has a role to care for the underdog. That's what makes us British too. And I want us to be round that table, to be the ones leading it. And funnily enough, I've got a meeting with the Prime Minister next week to talk to him about what I saw. And I'm hoping that he will lift our game and lead in that. You know, that's a strong reason to stay in the EU. We are better than this. We lead. And when people need our help, we're not the people that turn the other cheek. We've done rather too much of that.
Thank you. I'm going to turn to the main panel, but I think we hadn't really expressed any views before you arrived. But I think in Cambridge, and particularly in the university, broadly you're among friends in terms of desire to stay in the European Union and be constructive players. So anyway, thank you very much indeed. Sorry to put you in the spotlight.
Okay.
But unlike a bunny, you did survive. So thank you very much indeed.
Yes, thank you very much.
The proposal now would be that we go in the order that's on the programme, with speakers introducing themselves for whatever period they would like to introduce themselves for, and a few introductory remarks, maximum of 10 minutes. But if it's fewer than 10 minutes, we won't object. So starting with Jonathan, going to Charles, Bernard, and then Martin Noel, if that's...
Sure. Okay, I'm Jonathan Portis. I am also a senior fellow in the ESRC UK in a Changing Europe programme, for which whose financial support I am, of course, grateful. As such, I am, unlike Ms. Allen and unlike probably a majority of you in this room, strictly neutral and objective on the question of how people actually should vote in the referendum. Should be very clear about that. What I will try and do is give as most of you probably know, and unlike most, I think, of the panelists, I'm not a lawyer or an expert on European law, so I won't be talking about that. I'm an economist. I'll talk very briefly about the sort of economic history of free movement in Europe, and then a little bit about what we've seen over the last few years in the UK. As you all know, free movement, one of the four freedoms set out in the treaties back in the late 50s. So it's always been there. But the interesting thing from an economic history point of view is that free movement was not really that big a deal in the first 30 years or so of the EU's existence. There was very substantial immigration for work purposes to the major countries of the EU in that time, to Germany from Turkey, to France from North Africa, and to the UK from various former Commonwealth countries. But that was an immigration driven largely by historical and colonial ties, not because of the what was already then the legal right of free movement. And I think from an economic point of view, free movement really became highlighted as issue actually in the negotiations surrounding the Maastricht Treaty. Not many people, I suspect, know or remember this. I was part of the Treasury team that negotiated the Maastricht Treaty. A key question, a very important question, which we did a not terribly good job of answering, was what would be the adjustment mechanisms within a single currency area in the event of severe regionalised economic shocks. And a lot of that debate was conducted in the context of the theory of optimum currency areas, what makes an area suitable for a single currency, by analogy to the United States. And there were a couple of very influential papers, one by Olivier Blanchard, the well-known French macroeconomist who recently retired as head of the chief economist at the IMF, on comparing labour mobility in the European Union with labour mobility in the US, and noting that labour mobility, possibly even more than fiscal transfers, was a key adjustment mechanism by which the member states of the United States adjusted to economic shocks. And that this was not at all the case in the European Union. The monetary union went ahead anyway, but I think that was the beginning of a view among European policymakers that actually something needed to be done to facilitate labour mobility within the European Union. So there were then a variety of legal changes and directives aimed at actually turning the legal principle of free movement into something that could be practically applied. Of course, the real impetus to much higher labour mobility came in 2004 with the accession of 10 new member states to the European Union, in particular the A8 states of Central Eastern Europe and the Baltics, and the decision by a number of countries, including the UK, Ireland and Sweden primarily, to allow immediate free movement of workers to the UK and the other two countries, which immediately resulted in levels of labour mobility within the EU which had not been seen before. Those flows were then given a very substantial further impetus by the Great Recession, the Great Financial Crisis, and the ensuing recession, in particular, very, very severe recessions which hit certain countries in the Baltics and then in Southern Europe. So we've seen a much higher level of intra-EU labour mobility over the past 10 years than we saw in the 40 years previous to that. So what has that experience been? And I think in contrast to all the other adjustment mechanisms that we've had within monetary union, labour mobility has actually worked pretty well. It's one of the few things that we could talk about as a success story, as opposed to the coordination of fiscal and monetary policy, which has been an absolute disaster, partly because of the design failures of the euro and partly because of short-sighted behaviour on the part of view of European policymakers. Labour mobility seems to have worked quite well. It's done the job which it was supposed to do. It's acted as an adjustment mechanism. People have flowed from countries and areas where labour demand is weak and unemployment is high to places where labour demand has been, at least in relative terms, high, such as Germany and the UK. And that was what you would expect in a well-functioning economic union. And moreover, the effects appear, in most cases, to have been broadly benign. As you probably know, there's been a huge upsurge in research on the labour market impacts of immigration, everything from the sort of qualitative and legal focus studies of the sort that Catherine and Amy are doing, through to the quantitative econometric studies that people like I and some of my colleagues have done. And these have broadly shown that the impacts on receiving countries, and not just the UK, but also Ireland, Germany, and so on, have been broadly benign, At the same time, we've also seen that the impact on in sending countries has also been relatively positive. There have been, unemployment is probably lower and wages probably higher than they would otherwise have been in the sending countries as a consequence of emigration at a time of low labour demand. Now, I think that does come with medium to long-term caveat. Countries like Latvia, which have seen a very, very large outflow of relatively skilled workers, that's probably a good thing in the short term when you're going through a very, very severe recession and there just aren't any jobs. From the medium to long-term prospects of countries like Latvia, which was facing demographic challenges already, that is not necessarily a good thing. I think the challenge for the EU then will be this is something countries have to sort out for themselves. Latvia and Poland, the free movement genie is out of the bottle. Latvia and Poland aren't going to retain skilled workers by finding some way of stopping them from emigrating. What they're going to The only way they can for them to have a medium to long-term future in this respect is by finding policies which ensure that skilled workers want to remain in Latvia and Poland because there are good jobs and good prospects for them. So there's something of a challenge there. Finally, on the UK, in my 30 seconds or so, as I said, without being in any sense saying which way to vote, for me, the one really positive thing about this referendum is that, I've been working on immigration policy in this country in one form or another for the best part of the last two decades, as Charles knows. And there is not the one thing which really frustrates me most is people who say, whether it's on Twitter or email or whatever, and say, oh, all this immigration, we never voted for that. Open borders to the rest of the European Union, we were never asked. We never voted for that. And whatever you think of that argument from a constitutional or legal perspective, it has a lot of resonance out there. Well, this referendum gives a chance to sort that. The government's white paper on the renegotiation states very clearly, we support free movement, we think it's a good thing, it's been a good thing for the UK. So if the people of Britain choose to vote to stay in, it seems to me that settles that argument. Possibly with great reluctance, if we vote to stay in, we will then be able to say,
49-51.
Even so, this is a democracy. We have a referendum, and the question is clearly there on the ballot paper. If your vote remains, you're voting for free movement. You may not like free movement, but you're still voting for it, and you can't come back and whine about it afterwards. Similarly, that will not have the legitimacy or resonance it does now. Similarly, if we vote to leave, then we will have to sort out what an immigration policy this country is prepared to live with looks like outside the European Union. Thanks.
And if that doesn't worry you, maybe Charles Clarke can give us something to be even more worried about.
I hope not. I hope I'm going to be more positive. I've worked on migration quite a lot since I lost my seat in the 2010 general election. I work with UCL, the CREAM unit at UCL. We've done quite a lot of work on the impact here. I work with the Migration Policy Institute based in Washington and Brussels, which does a variety of different things. But I came to it all very fresh when I was asked to be Home Secretary in December 2004 with a view to trying to get our policies on migration clear before the general election in 2005. My own view was and is that it is not the case that the UK is full of racists of various kinds who can't stand migrants coming to the country. My view is that there's a massive lack of confidence in the governance of migration to this country. People feel very concerned about it. They can't understand who's in the country and why they're in the country and what they're doing. A thing which is exacerbated by some of the mass media and their distortions of the situation that happens, but also exacerbated by real events. I remember a police officer was killed by an illegal migrant during the time I was Home Secretary in this period. And of course, people think, well, it's bad enough a police officer being killed, but by somebody who shouldn't even have been here. So all the doubts about the governance come very high. So it seemed to me, and still seems to me, that the core issue was to try and establish confidence in the governance of migration.
I'll come to the EU in the in a second, where it seems to me that confidence in governance by the EU of migration, or by the EU and EU member states of migration, is extremely low at the moment for all the reasons which are entirely obvious. But my effort to try and deal with it was to publish a white paper on migration in January 2005, which firstly set out what were the criteria for the different forms of migration: migration to work, migration to study, migration to family reunite, and then the fourth, which isn't really migration, I'm well aware, asylum, that often gets confused with migration in that context. And my view was and is that you needed very clear and transparent rules in each of those categories, that those rules needed to be well understood and broadly supported, and by the way, I think that is the case, they are broadly supported at the moment, but then well operated, well enforced, and carried through in an effective way. That was a massive weakness that we had then and still exists now. When I became Home Secretary, there were rooms the size of this, full of filing cabinets going back 5 years of asylum seekers, where the files had never been opened, the questions had never happened, the discussions had never been taken. And the reason was that the system had not taken on enough people of enough quality to do it. And at the same time, a large number of the asylum decisions which the Home Office was taking were being overruled in the courts as not being competent in respect A, respect B, or respect C. And it seemed, then and seems to me that that was the core issue that we had to address. The White Paper was enacted into law. It established for non-EU migrants a point system, which I still think was the right approach to follow. And then over a period of years from 2005, gradually that system was bedded in. It has had strengths and weaknesses as it's gone through, but I still think is the right approach. What it didn't address, that migration white paper in January 2005, was migrants from the EU. Mm-hmm. We were clear that the free movement within the EU should be sustained. There was no suggestion at any time when I was preparing that white paper from any part of government that we should somehow be changing the free movement rules within the EU. And so we didn't seriously consider that as a possibility. Now, and by the way, I should say, I'll come to the A8 question in just a moment. That was after the A8 decisions had been taken about the first group of migrants from those countries. Now, I'm of the view myself, apropos your Honeypot Britain project, that the reasons why people want to come and live in Britain are the nature of our society, the nature of our economy, and I'd also add to that our language, which is a big factor compared to many other countries. Those are overwhelmingly, in my experience, the reasons why people want to come and live and work here. It's not about people seeking benefits and all the various other issues which are chucked around. I simply don't believe that is the case. Now, I hope, Catherine, that your project here that you and Amy are doing, when it analyses this, will broadly say I'm right in what I'm saying, but that doesn't always happen, of course.
I say
you can cut out all that academic work and money that we're spending on your work, just accept my prejudice as based on the facts that you go forward. But I do concede, joking aside, that given the controversy that's been around these issues, it is very important to try and analyse, as far as one can, what really are the motivations that lead people to do it. But I don't want to change our society in a way that makes people not want to live here. It's been, Jonathan just talked about the Commonwealth migration at various points. The fact is that many, many of those people, I've talked to them in many constituencies, many parts of Britain, wanted to come here because the kind of society that we represented was a very positive thing compared with the societies which they've been brought up in. People wanted to be here with our freedoms and so on that were attached to where we were. And of course, jobs is an important component of it, but by no means the only component of it. You'll often find many migrants from the former Commonwealth countries, for example, very, very positive about the fundamental values. I was a bit sceptical about the citizenship proposals that we carried through, but it's very moving. If you go to any citizenship ceremony and see what people talking about citizenship as they take it on, there's a very powerful emotional expression about the values of the society in which people have come to be here. On the A8 question, my broad analysis is that what happened then was political failure, including by the Labour Party, and phrases like British jobs for British workers and things of that kind just completely eroded what should have been a fairly confident position that we were able to take forward. I don't agree with the proposition, which has been widely described, that we were wrong to admit the A8 countries in 2004, quickly and rapidly, the three countries which Jonathan described. It wasn't actually my decision, it happened before I was Home Secretary, but I did very, very strongly support it, and I was Secretary of State for Education and Skills at that time, and by definition, because of the skills component, we were an important part of the discussion that took place. It is the case that there was an assumption that Germany probably would also be amongst that first group of countries, and it decided not to be, and that meant more than would perhaps otherwise have been the case. People were coming from the A8 countries to the UK rather than slightly more widely across the EU. But the criticism that was made, and was made, for example, by the Labour opposition in the last Parliament, that if only we'd had a tighter transitional process, we hadn't let people in at that time, everything would have been a lot better, I fundamentally think is incorrect. The fact is that there was to be a 7-year transition. We had to choose between 0 and 7. Our economy was in a relatively strong position. We were in a better position at that time to deal with people who were going to migrate here. And though there were arguments about the assessments made by academics, which the government accepted, about how many people would or wouldn't come, for me, that was not the key argument. At that time. A range of, and I watched this question then very carefully during the whole of the rest of my time in Parliament, and I'm afraid I sound like an ostrich head in the sand politician, but I myself have yet to really see the very strong negative effects which some allege to be the case as a result of the A8 migrants that came to this country. I talked to lots of people, I talked to people who believed there were problems. My political friend John Denham, the MP for Southampton, motivated by UKAT, a trade union issue about what was happening to jobs and wages in the building trade and construction trade in Southampton, built a whole argument, which has now got a centre of Englishness, which is established as a result. But I have to say, I don't believe it was a general thing. There were issues, there were people obviously worried about migration. The many people I talked to about this actually were more worried about it from what they've read in the newspapers than from their personal experience. And so I'm afraid I'm the head in the sand tendency when it comes to the real alleged negative effects of that migration that took place. I think there were some effects on wages in some sectors of the economy. I think the famous Polish plumbers did provide a more efficient, more effective competition to some of the people who'd been here before. And so people were damaged by that. I would say that was better for the consumer, as a matter of fact, in that process, and actually moved it forward. But I don't believe there were the very dramatic effects that there were. I went to Bulgaria and Romania shortly before I was sacked as Home Secretary, talked to people in those countries about their accession to the EU, partly on criminal justice. Thank you, Julie. I was of the view, had I stayed Home Secretary, I would have said that Bulgaria and Romania too, we should have done what we did with the A8, the first A8, and allowed the transition immediately into the UK. And I don't think waiting the 7 years that we would have done, that we in fact did do, would have made the situation particularly better as far as that overall situation is concerned. The only change that I can see that might be beneficial when countries are acceding into the EU is to make it a shorter transition period of seven years, and hoping to be in a situation that more countries would agree to do it simultaneously, rather than having a competition between the existing EU countries as to who did after 0 years, who did after 5 years, who did after 7 years, etc., etc., etc. So I come finally to where we are now in the EU context. I wrote this pamphlet, The EU and Migration, A Call for Action, after I left Parliament, and I believe the EU absolutely faces that crisis of confidence in the governance of migration as a result of the enormous refugee crisis there has been. I'm very strongly critical of the EU for failing to act over the last 4 or 5 years. I've tried in various ways myself to press that with various people, but not just the EU itself, but the various EU member governments have not been ready, in my view, to face up to what needs to be done. In my opinion, the core thing that needs to be done, the first order problem, is to secure the external border of Schengen, in particular the southern border of the EU. And that is done firstly by establishing strong bilateral relations with the countries on the border in North Africa and elsewhere. And that hasn't been done. We basically watched while the Arab Spring took place and weren't involved in trying to support those economies in any substantial way, in my view. And established then a fast-track means of dealing with the various applications when they arise, and then a proper system for returns and readmission, and I would add to it a serious attack on people smuggling. At the moment, 90% of the people who come through are being facilitated by people smugglers who have enormous profits and zero risk of getting caught, and I think that could be stopped by simple police action in very significant ways. I think the second order problems, which the EU is in fact focused on, the distribution of the 160,000 migrants, which in my opinion is completely destined to fail, and it will be a further disaster and damage relationships, are not the right way to approach it. It should be the first order issue, which is securing the external border. I can go into, which is not a question of barbed wire, by the way, it's a question of a whole set of different relationships between the EU and its neighbours. I could happily go into detail in that if anybody is interested, and I've set out some of the detail even in my rather outdated pamphlet, but I think, Julie, I've probably overrun my time, and so I will draw it to a pause at this moment.
Thank you. Well, we'll come back to you in questions. Bernard.
Thank you. My name is Bernard Ryan. I'm Professor of Immigration Law at the University of Leicester, and I could probably speak to a variety of questions in the migration law and policy field. I had intended to speak primarily about employment law. I thought that would be more prominent, shall we say, in the seminar. But I will perhaps downplay that in my remarks. So I'm partly doing this off the cuff. I have no hesitation about saying that I'm in favour of remaining, and I hope everyone will vote to remain in the European Union. I'm from Ireland. I'm from the west of Ireland, and I have no hesitation about saying, you know, this is actually a fantastic country, and the debate about migration and the phenomenon of migration here is very much linked to the strength, it seems to me, of the United Kingdom as a place to live. I can say that coming from a neighbouring country, and I'm sure that is a common sense of people who come here, who want to come here, who do come here, and who stay here. And I very much was glad to hear the way in which Charles Clarke phrased it. It's not just about the economy; it's also about the nature of the society. I would say the nature of the state as well in the United Kingdom, a particularly stable and, in comparative terms, not corrupt state. And I think these are some of the things that people value about coming here. And I do find it strange how many British people don't seem to grasp the strengths of their society that make it so attractive for people to come and work and stay. Many do, of course, but many do not. And that is a particular frustration of mine in discussions around migration. And of course, migration contributes. And I mean, we only have to look at the incredible size, the incredible share that the foreign-born and foreign nationals now have within the labour market, within the world of employment, to understand that. I mean, I looked it up before coming. The latest figures are 16% of people in work are foreign-born, 10% are foreign nationals. Each of these is I'm sure, a historical high. These figures have increased year on year for the last 20, probably longer, 25 years. If you go all the way back through the post-war, over every decade, the percentage of foreign-born in employment has been increasing. Migrants contribute, and they have contributed for decades to the British economy and the British society, I suppose, more widely. And I just find it very difficult to imagine what it would be like the day afterwards, the day after it becomes apparent that Britain has left the European Union and is also walking away from the single market, is walking away from a ready labour supply within the EU. I find it very difficult to imagine what that would be and what British society would really look like if there was a serious attempt to reduce the level of foreign-born or foreign nationals or new migration into it. I don't think it's viable. I think that there would be enormous economic and social dislocation if that were to take place. And I think this is some of the things that really ought to come out in the referendum campaign. And I have been having conversations with people about, you know, wanting to present some fairly technical summaries of EU law around the referendum, and I think that's not what this is about. This is about the choice between where we are and what the alternative would be, and the alternative that no one has described, it seems to me, in terms of immigration. Jonathan mentioned this, what would a future immigration policy look like? I don't think we have even the beginning of an answer to that question. I mean, I find it, you think about the current arrangement where roughly 50% of net migration is from outside the EU and roughly 50% is from inside, and we have over 300,000 per annum. That's a system to me. It's not the case that you can just switch off the EU and imagine that somehow the non-EU policy is then going to apply to everybody. It just couldn't work like that. The other half of net migration and those that are already here from those countries, those places in the society, those places in the labour market will still be there. And a future policy would have to respond to that. It couldn't just be a generalisation of the fairly restrictive policy towards non-EU migration that we have at present. And no one seems to me to be talking about that. So I think where I'm going, I suppose, is to say that whatever the outcome, I guess there are three possible outcomes: staying in, leaving, but staying in the single market somehow, and leaving altogether. Whatever the outcome, it seems to me that there will continue to be a significant presence of foreign nationals and a significant continuing migration to the United Kingdom. And personally, I wish, you know, we could have more detail about what people think the real alternatives would look like. But whatever they would be, there would be large numbers involved. Turning a little bit to employment law, where I think employment law fits into the discussion around migration is really as an alternative way, not the only one by any means, but one of probably several alternative ways of thinking of other ways out of the policy impasse, the policy dilemma that the United Kingdom seems to have ended up with, where, generally speaking, there, at least for much of the population and for many in the political class, migration is too high. The price of reducing it seems to be certain, if that means leaving the EU or the single market, is also too high. And there's something of a policy impasse about what to do. And I think we will need, certainly if we stay within the EU, but also if we leave, it seems other ideas about how migration can be, and particularly labour migration, can be better handled and made less painful, for the society, made less painful in social terms, in how people understand what's going on. I actually agree with what Charles Clark said about this, that, you know, where the real examples concretely of things going badly wrong, well, you might struggle to find them, but there's a sense that they are. Yeah. And it's not just the actual phenomena that need to be addressed, it's also that sense that does need to be addressed, it seems to me. And if it can't be addressed by just stopping migration, it can't be addressed by leaving the EU, well, we do need other ways of doing that. And I think labour law has a part to play. And of course, the long history of employment law, or labour market regulation, is one of a tendency towards a more flexible labour market. And I think there has been a price to be paid in political terms around migration for that flexible labour market. I guess that's my general starting point. We have ended up with a market where labour market intermediaries, agencies and so on, are central and with great potential for abuse there. We have a very weak enforcement regime across the board. I was actually I've been recently trying to help somebody get paid in someone I know in Leicester, and it's extraordinary how difficult it is even to begin the process of finding someone who can help in bringing a claim to wages. The official information through ACAS and so on is quite impenetrable, and it's actually a step. Ultimately, it's the revenue that one has to go to, but there's no direct way of doing it. Certainly, you can't phone them up. Meanwhile, tribunals are there are now fees, and county courts, of course, have fees as well. So there's a whole, you know, there's no ready-made system by which someone who in the labour market is not getting what they should, even in a very sort of common or garden way, where they can go and do something about that. And that is a serious aspect, it seems to me, of the labour market is the weakness of enforcement systems. There are also mention has been made of the British jobs for British workers controversy. I mean, a lot of that story was about the weakness in the supports for collective agreements in British employment law. The fact that it, although EU law got blamed because of posted workers and so on, in truth, there was a solution within the United Kingdom law that wasn't being used, which was to extend terms of collective agreements to non-parties. And that is something I would argue should be reconsidered, as part of any re-examination, shall we say, of employment law in the light of migration and the migration debate. There are quite a number of things that could be considered. Maybe one point I would make as well, just thinking about the alternative universe post single market, if that ever were to happen. One thing I think there's not been picked up on is that there would presumably be a lot more work without immigration permission taking place in the UK than at present. In other words, it would increase significantly the presence of irregular employment. And one of the legal issues around that is irregular migrant workers are excluded from all protection in employment law. And that's not a big practical matter right now. Occasionally, it's not a big practical matter, but in a genuinely post single market environment, that is something that would undoubtedly need to be considered. I mean, I think just to wrap up, in the employment law area, what I think I'm arguing is there are a variety of changes that could be made that would go to the question of addressing exploitation of migrants, addressing undercutting by migrants, and even if they are not as anything like as extensive phenomena as is believed, they would go to the perception that they are. A more stable, less flexible labour market with higher minimum standards, more security of employment, all of these would, it seems to me, better enable migration, which will continue to be absorbed. And I think I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much indeed. And last but very much not least, we turn to Marie-Noël from New Europeans. And I know that one of your big things is the point that Marcus was making earlier about getting votes for EU nationals. So I'm really sorry that EU nationals don't have a vote in the referendum. We did argue for it, but over to you.
Well, it is indeed a real shame because many of us will be affected by whatever the UK decides to do in June. Yes, my name is Marie. I'm the trustee of on an organisation called EU Europeans, and as you can probably tell by my accent, I grew up in Germany. I also have a French mother, moved to the UK about nine years ago, so I guess I'm somewhat a prototype of a European citizen, really. And I'm here to give the perspective of an immigrant. And I'm very grateful to Amy and Catherine to have invited me to speak on this panel, because it's very seldom that a debate about freedom of movement actually includes people who have exercised that right. And so with Bernard and I, you have too, so that's fantastic. New Europeans is an organization that represents EU mobile citizens and gives them a voice. And we are perhaps more on the idealistic side of the debate on Europe, but I'd like to think that doesn't make us wrong. For us, freedom of movement is not only about the right to cross borders, but it is also about the right to settle somewhere and to be as free in the host country as you were in your home country. And that comes with a range of rights and duties. Of course, it means that you as an immigrant have to make an effort to integrate in your new society. And I appreciate that not everybody does. But it also means that, you are able to vote and that you pay taxes. And yes, it also means that you are able to claim benefits when you have to. But let me be very, very clear on this. As an immigrant, you do not leave your home country. You do not leave your family. You do not leave your support system. You do not leave often much better weather and food just to claim benefits in another country. That is simply not the case. Some of us come to start a new life, to open new businesses. Some of us just have an adventure. And, you know, some of us do come to work very, very hard to provide support to their families back home. And, you know, some of us come only for a few years, for a few months. Freedom of movement has made all of that very possible. Personally, I meant to stay for only 3 months. It's been 9 years now. So, and you know, I came because I stayed, really, because Britain is a wonderful country. It's got a fantastic sense of humour, which, you know, Germans don't really do. it's very open. It had a little bit to do with beef and Stilton pie, I'm not going to lie. But this referendum, it makes me, and I think it makes a lot of other EU mobile citizens, incredibly nervous and incredibly uncomfortable and anxious about the future that we have in this country. And that is partly because the narrative about free movement in parts of the media completely borders on the hysterical. I mean, you might remember the reports that that there would be buses and planes full of Romanians and Bulgarians that would arrive here once the transitional restriction had been removed. You may have noticed that that didn't happen. After the deal was announced, we at New Europeans actually got a phone call from several Bulgarian journalists asking what in the world in-work benefits actually were. So the deal itself, if it is approved and if the UK chooses to stay in the EU, which I very much hope it does, it's not going to stop people from coming. But the narrative and the changed attitudes over the last few years about how open Britain is and how welcoming it is to immigrants, that actually might. And it is a shame that the debate about the UK's membership of the EU is so often about the economic benefits and the trade and the single market and, you know, about what an awful bureaucracy it is. And because to us, at New Europeans, the EU is so much more. It's about being a region of shared values. It's about having a common history. It's about values such as equality and diversity and solidarity. And yes, of course, it's incredibly bureaucratic, but it's 28 member states peacefully making decisions, or trying to at least. I mean, bureaucracy is democracy is. It's never not going to be that easy. It never is going to be. That doesn't mean it's not worth it. The positive narrative that this is being used rather seldomly, and I think that is a real shame, because I think if it was, part of the UK would be more comfortable with being part of the Union, of the European Union, and maybe you'd even feel a little bit flattered that so many of us choose to live here and that we ultimately want you to stay in the European Union. So I realised that I didn't really answer the question of whether it's time to rethink free movement. I would say it's not. But it is perhaps time for the British to, not only the British, but we're in Britain here, so it's time for the British to endorse the idea of free movement and to be more positive about it. And that's not going to happen overnight. It includes some long-term changes. It will include things like putting more emphasis on teaching other languages at school, because that will then actually enable more UK citizens to exercise their right of free movement and go and work abroad. I mean, just as an example, in France, I think they start teaching English now when kids are five. So it's no wonder that it's easier for people to come here than for British citizens to come over there, to go abroad. And I realise that's not going to change overnight. I realise this is not going to change in time for the referendum. But I do hope it will at some point. So I don't want to take up more of your time, really. I don't know how much time I have. But if I may, let me just finish with a pitch for New Europeans, because we are a small membership organization campaigning for European citizens, campaigning for human rights. And if you want to be part of that, you can join us by going online. You can join and become a member from £12 a year. For students, it's £3. And you can be part of making that change and hopefully making the UK more comfortable with being EU citizens.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you to all of the speakers. I'm hoping Catherine might let me have an extra 5 minutes, so about 20 minutes for questions. And I will open it up ideally to people who didn't ask in the first round with Heidi Allen. So, Chris, are you waving your pen?
I am, yes. Thanks very much.
Professor Hill.
First of all, it's Chris Hill from Politics and International Studies. First of all, it's such a relief to have the debate raised a bit, or the discussion on migration raised a level or two from what we've been used to in the press in the last few weeks.
Difficult.
Secondly, I found myself actually quite moved by what Bernard and Marie said about paying tribute to the nature of British society. And it's true that we have had in the past a great tradition of giving asylum to refugees before 1939 and so on, and also of openness to economic migration. I mean, the great wave of Afro-Caribbean migration and Uganda nations and so on, I mean, not without problems, of course, but nonetheless managed in some form or other. Of course, there were some very rocky moments like Rivers of Blood and all the rest of it, but those were, broadly speaking, overcome, and I'm not Pollyannaish about, you know, the nature of race relations and so on even now, but those were overcome. And that's partly, I think, because another part of the British tradition has been, of course, gradual change, going back to Burke and beyond, and the idea that you have to accept new developments, you have to be open to the world, but at the same time, you have to not push it too hard. And that brings me a bit to the point of that Jonathan made about the, what he called, I think, the broadly benign effects for the receiving and the sending countries. And perhaps you'll forgive me if I say that I think that's a sort of, in a way, it's a typical economist's perspective on it, because clearly there have been upsides of both a material kind and other kinds, actually, of the movement for both countries. But there are things which have been more difficult. So if, you know, lots of young Spanish and Italians are coming and living in London because they've got no jobs back at home, it doesn't necessarily mean that their life then becomes possible, that they can buy a house and make a family, often many of them in significant difficulties. It doesn't necessarily either solve the problems of economic stagnation in their home country. So there's a degree of adjustment, but there, what is not is necessarily the building of a community. And that brings me back to my previous point, that is, gradual change is also about preserving the best things of a community and bringing new benefits to that community. It's a bit like, you know, not that I'm great at this, but baking a cake, in the sense that if you get the mix of ingredients right, it holds together, and if you don't, it starts to fall apart. And we have to, I don't think the question is, do we have, you know, no zero immigration, no complete borders. The simple issue is about the management of inevitable migration, pace and scale and so on. And it's not just a question of whether or not economic benefits are in the plus column or in the minus column, because it's a wider range of criteria for that. The last thing I'd like to say is in relation to Charles. I think he's absolutely right about the external border issue. But of course, the caravan has moved on. You know, we've now got such a major war, not only in Syria, but incipiently in Libya. Mm-hmm. And readmission agreements are simply not on the table, really, as a possible solution. I think we've got to do absolutely everything that we can on that front, and he outlined most of the options. But unfortunately, we are where we are, and we now have to deal with a situation in which we have effectively, or the German Chancellor has encouraged, 1 million people actually to walk across Europe, and is rewarded for her humanitarianism in doing that. I think that there's a much bigger political and strategic challenge before us to try and deal with that problem.
Thank you. I'm minded to take a few comments and questions, but there don't seem to be a raft of... Oh, Geoffrey.
Well, if I'm allowed...
Yes.
Thank you. Follow on from Chris in one sense, and just Charles, insofar as he was in government. The white paper envisaged opening the borders with the enlargement to Central and Eastern European countries. To what extent at that point were health ministries, the health minister, housing minister, and so on, actually involved in those decisions, simply because one of the great cries now is, of course, of the pressure on housing, health services, and so on and so forth. Now, okay, so one can argue that the financial crisis, the economic crisis from 2008, began to impact on any extra spending. But to what extent was there anticipation at that point of the impact of increased migration? And to Jonathan, I wonder, if you could break the figures down for me a bit in terms of
especially flattening wages and so on. Which industries, and has there been work on which industries have been particularly adversely affected, and which regions have been particularly adversely affected?
Catherine.
I have a question for Bernard. I was moved by your call for a return to a more stable, less flexible labour market. That seems to me to be off the agenda for at least another 5 years and possibly much longer, depending on what happens at the next election. And so the question is, given that the likelihood of that happening seems somewhat slim, what then can be done to help some of these groups of people?
And then Marcus, and then I'll come back to Pam.
Yes, I had a concrete, a very legal question. We saw this negotiation by the Prime Minister also on the Narendra Singh kind of scenario where you exercise your free movement rights and then it's much harder for UK authorities to reject the residency of your spouse. Do you think their courts might look at this and have their doubts?
Bernard, it looks as if Marcus is looking to you. Yes.
Two, yeah. But could you just clarify the question? Sorry, this is about, see, there's more than one thing in the deal about spouses. One is about the abuse issue, and then there's a different thing about lawful residence.
Lawful residence, yeah.
Do you want to?
Yes.
Do you want to do it? Okay. Why don't I deal with them in reverse order? Thank you for asking that question, because it enables me to say that I actually think the deal that was done was a very bad day for the EU. And I realise it may have helped to save British membership, but there is a trend away from the body of rights that was accumulated over the long post-war period within Europe and within the EU around equal treatment and around family reunion as critical to a level playing field for movement everywhere in the European Union, something like that. And it seems to me that it may be small, but somehow a concession has been made on both of these things, that within work benefits, nationality discrimination will be accepted. And with the proposed regime around spouses, they won't be treated the same in their first residence in every member state, and that's fragmentation. So there's something has been given up, actually, something profound, even if it's only a small shift from that high point. The lawful residence idea, that of course is, may people will know this, that was put in place in a case called Akrich, the lawful residence precondition in 2003. It always had lots of problems from a legal perspective, not least of which that it wasn't mentioned in the secondary legislation. Then the court came along and said, we got that wrong, we're going to go back, and that was Metoc. So in a sense now that the states, through the council, want to put it back in secondary legislation, and I suspect it would be difficult to challenge. Certainly, I mean, there may be cases where, sorry if I could be technical, a Zambrano-type argument could be used, you know, a citizenship-based argument could be used to get a certain spouse residence, but I don't think the whole rule will fall. I think the whole rule, if it's put in secondary legislation, will be immune to challenge. I mean, the other thing it's actually about saying, I mean, that is, I mean, that's just about interpretation of a principle that's there, and it's maybe an encouragement to the Court of Justice to accept the idea of abuse and take it more seriously, but the idea of abuse is in the case law already. So I don't see that that's actually a profound change relative to, a change really relative to where we are. Employment law, what can be done? I mean, I suppose I partly put it on the table because I think it frustrates me, I suppose, that there's people are prepared to accept migration and argue for migration without thinking about the employment law, that dimension to it. It frustrates me that we can have a debate about migration without thinking about the flexible labour market that's part of the story. There has been an interesting convergence over the past, since 2010, since Labour went out of office, convergence of the debates, and you're finding labour migration or labour market issues within the immigration debates. Labour did that first, and eventually the coalition stroke conservatives responded. So we have this strange director of labour market enforcement in the current immigration bill. So something is shifting, I think, in recognising somehow or putting something in place, but it's just not very extensive. But either in terms of the content of the norms or in terms of the changes to the enforcement regime that are likely to follow. But I don't think it depends on there being a Labour government or a Labour government or a particular stripe. I mean, I think a range of political parties can see that there something more needs to be done in the labour market than in an era of migration.
Jonathan.
Okay. Three things, I think. First of all, differential impacts on different bits of the labour market. Best evidence we have is in the recent Bank of England paper by Nico and Salah Habib, which looks at impacts by sector. So the biggest impact on wages is found in what they describe as the low and medium skilled service sector. So this is basically people working in supermarkets or in Pret-a-Manger or Starbucks or whatever, which indeed, from a sort of anecdotal visible area, is indeed where lots of recent European Union migrants are concentrated. So they find an impact of an elasticity of about 0.2. What does that translate to in real money? Well, the answer is that given the magnitude of immigration in that sector, it means that over the last decade, roughly since the 2004, wages in that sector have been pushed down by, according to these estimates, by about 1%. Now, that is not, I don't want to minimize the impact of 1%, 150 pounds a year, say, for somebody on the minimum wage. That's not a trivial amount of money, but it's not a lot of money either. It translates to about one penny an hour off your annual wage increase, or eight or 10p over an hour off your wages over the whole decade. So that's not, as I say, not totally insignificant, and is statistically significant in the analysis, but equally it's pretty small compared to, say, the impact of national minimum wage going up by 50p in April, or the impact of a bunch of other things which we know from the literature also impact wages, such as technological change, decline of trade unions, the other sort of general labour market law type issues that Bernard referred. So, yeah, not entirely trivial, but pretty small. Otherwise, impact on jobs, nobody's found any. We've got a bunch of econometric studies, none of them have come up with statistically impact on employment prospects. So yes, there are impacts, but in the data, it's pretty small. Second of all, this point about planning, housing, health, I'm pretty frankly, we messed up housing policy for a long time. We did it before this rapid increase in immigration flows. Did it after. When you look at specific areas where there have been problems, it's clearly a failure of planning, not an immigration policy. We knew that there was going to be a huge bulge in the number of primary school kids in London 5 years before it happened, because it wasn't them who immigrated, it was their parents who immigrated. Yes, it's a problem of resulting from immigration, they're mostly the kids of immigrants, but it wasn't that we didn't know about it 3, 4, 5 years ahead, we just failed to do something about it. So it's just bad planning, and I think that's true of most of the areas where immigration has led to local service pressures. Finally, the mixing a cake point. I'm not a big fan of this metaphor. I could speak for hours on the literature on immigration, ethnicity, diversity, and social cohesion, social pressure. But, And I won't, but very
because there's coffee outside and maybe there's
coffee outside, but very briefly, immigrant flows in, say, Bradford and Oldham were steady, relatively slow, and manageable perfectly in a physical sense, but have been dreadfully managed in an integration and cohesion sense. Whereas immigration flows to Newham, say, have been huge, chaotic in the sense that nobody's managed them at all. They just happened. Without any attempt from central government at controlling, managing or planning, the council's just been left to cope. Yeah, on the whole, they've actually done a pretty good job of it. And if you go to Newham schools, it's all sort of fine. So, your basic point is, of course, correct, that change has to be, that societies have to accommodate change, and it happens better in some places than others. But it's not simply a question of, if you just get the cake, the rest of the ingredients of the cake precisely right, of course, anybody can make a perfect sponge if they follow the instructions. That's not how it works.
I wish I'd never said that, but the rise of populism and UKIP and all the rest of it is a fact which has to be built into your mould.
Right, along with the Great European Bake Off. Charles, failure of planning.
I can't talk about the Great European Bake Off, I'm afraid. Number of points. Firstly, people should underestimate at their peril in this discussion the actual attitudes of the people of this country. So, for example, if you poll attitudes to asylum, the majority of people are in favour of offering asylum to people who are in difficulty, contrary to what many people think. And you go through the various categories of migration, but actually that view of the people of the country, which varies of course from time to time, is misrepresented by the general media as a whole, and therefore the policy climate in which this is looked at is infected in the wrong way. But it's important not to believe that kind of the dirty populace out there doesn't want all people and so on. It's not the case. Secondly, on the community point, last night in UEA in Norwich, I chaired a conversation between Saeed Avasi, the former cabinet minister, and Akhil Ahmed, who runs religious broadcasting for the BBC, who came respectively from Dewsbury and Bolton, and as Muslims, and gone up through this life in these communities and gone right through in a quite extraordinary way, demonstrating their capacity to play a big role in society in lots of kind of ways. I think the point about the populism, Chris, is completely right, but I think it's quite important to try and disentangle the populism debate, what is driving UKIP and alienation of probably up to 25 or 30% of people in this country, from the migration question. I don't think they're the same question. And I think they need to be disentangled to some extent when one's thinking them through. The external borders, I of course agree with you. The fundamental issue about migration into the EU is the reason why people are fleeing various parts of the world. Syria is the obvious example, but of course many others too. And those are circumstances where the argument's different. It's about, could the EU do better to try and solve some of those problems in the way that it operates? But that doesn't mean they're not also immediate issues around the border, which one could deal with in a different way. I mean, I think if the EU had operated in a different way, literally thousands of less people would have been killed over the last 4 or 5 years. Thousands of less people would have been killed on the Mediterranean by what happened and by the people smugglers operating in the way that they did. That doesn't take away from your fundamental rightness, but it's actually about fundamental inequalities in the world, fundamental dangers in the world. Question, can the EU do better to address those? On the enlargement issues, Geoffrey, the answer is yes. Everybody was fully involved in the discussions, very much so. And I don't just think it's planning. I mean, you take the primary school in example that Jonathan just gives. My children went to London primary schools, as all London primary schools just about. This was in London, in Hackney. There are dozens of languages spoken, over 100 in the school that my children went to. Do I believe they got a worse education as a result? Well, actually, I don't. And when we moved to Norwich, the standard of education went down significantly than what had been the case of the very diverse community that we lived in Hackney. And I'm very unconvinced, even on the planning issue. I mean, there are planning failures, particularly on pupil numbers. I don't dispute that. but I don't think in terms of the different character of schools as a result of the migration that's taken place, that there has been a serious problem in the quality of education of the, quotes, indigenous population, unquotes. Health, I'm again pretty sceptical at the end of the day. What really are the health problems, healthcare problems, which have arisen from migration? I think it's quite difficult to identify them in a very serious and direct way. Because, of course, you have to remember that as people migrate into the country, they also contribute to the economic public sector in the ability to pay for the services that are needed in different ways. Housing is a different case, where I think there's been a total failure of public policy in housing over a long period of time, and a lot of the issues aren't there. There are serious issues about how you deal with rented housing as opposed to owned housing and so on and so forth, about those issues are dealt with. But again, just to blow the UCL trumpet again, a very good document was produced not that long ago, going through all these arguments about pressure on public services, wages and so on, which really rubbished quite a lot of the arguments that are made by many of the anti-migrant forces. My only worry about what Catherine said is the idea of a more stable labour market, when she was responding to Bernard's comments, which I agreed with, is that a chimera? Is it really the case that we can somehow put back in the bottle the idea of the kind of labour market that we had some time ago? I think it's quite difficult to see. I think simply the nature of the globalised world, the nature of the labour market, makes it quite difficult to see how that operates. Now, that's not against what Bernard said about improving the role of the state agencies in control of abuse in labour conditions. I think there's a lot of issues to be said there, but I'm quite doubtful whether that adds up to getting back to stability in some sense. I'm not sure whether that really is achievable. I think the final point is about politics after the referendum. I think I'm much more optimistic than this. Before the EU referendum, the position within the Conservative government in terms of attitudes, for example, to students coming to work here, was changing very significantly. You had David Cameron and Theresa May holding a line in terms of the position on students and where they should be classified. Large numbers of other parts of the government, including at very senior level, including the Chancellor of Exchequer, including Secretary of State for Business, wanting to change the rules in this area. I thought Heidi's remarks were quite significant in this, in the way she's looking. But David Cameron has not felt able to relax any of those points prior to the existential question of his whole premiership, viz. The EU referendum. And so he's not going to do anything before June the 23rd, which gives any ammunition to anybody about being, quote, soft on migration, unquote. However, on the assumption that he wins his position, which I both hope and believe he will, I think there is a lanced boil. It will represent a massive defeat, if he wins, of a force within Conservative politics which has been nasty, poisonous, inward-looking, dangerous, and has dominated British politics for as long as 20 years in different ways. And I'm personally more optimistic after that point, even with David Cameron, that it will be possible to, and will actually happen, that there'll be a more relaxed approach to thinking about the nature of the country that we are in this situation. I certainly don't think we should put people who think, as has been said in the audience, should just be putting all the Conservatives in that bag and saying, well, they're all awful until the day when the Conservatives are swept from office, in my expectation, about 2055.
Are we on the record?
As yet, Labour hasn't yet convinced me that we can win before 2055. And I have to say, Julie, the Liberal Democrats aren't doing much better either at this particular time. But the I'm not entirely joking about the length of time, but I do think it's important people think that even with a Conservative government post-referenda, there might be a different climate, and it's worth putting forward arguments, suggestions for the kind of society that we ought to be trying to create without saying, wait for a new government and turn it around in those circumstances.
Thank you. Marie, you have the last word, and you've already said that the UK is a good place to come to as a migrant.
It's a fantastic place to come to. But I do like the idea of a European bake-off, I have to say. On what Charles said, that the EU could definitely do better on the refugee crisis, that's absolutely true. The EU could do an awful lot better on an awful lot of things. But what's happening at the moment, one of the reasons why the debate about a EU referendum is just, the timing of this debate is just so horrific, and it has met with so much resistance from other European member states because of the timing, because of the state in which the EU is at the moment. I think one European diplomat put it quite fittingly, I thought, that the UK is basically asking for the furniture to be rearranged while the house is burning down. So my hope is that once the question about whether the UK will be in or out on the will be answered on the 23rd of June, and I'm not quite as optimistic at Tarts's, but I hope he's right, that we can then focus as Europeans again about making Europe what it was meant to be, about, you know, dealing sufficiently effectively and through solidarity with the refugee crisis, and I don't know, clean up the house, I suppose. On populism, yes, Chris, you're right, it's an awful problem. I think, and I appreciate that this is an academic audience, I'm from a campaigning background, so I guess my plea to you all is to speak up and raise the level of the debate on Europe in the, meet the populism, meet it with facts, meet it with engagement. Let's stop talking about evil immigrants and straight bananas or whatever it was that was one of their favorite things. And let's talk about what Europe can be and what the UK in Europe can do.
Thank you very much indeed. I think that's been a fantastic opening to the afternoon. There are four more speakers after coffee. 10 minutes? So if people could be back in about 10 minutes. But thank you all to the panellists, and maybe we can give them a round of applause.